محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين سفن النجاة الأعلام من ركب سفينتهم نجا من تخلف عنها هلك وغرق ثم أما بعد Respected elders, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are going back to our original topic on the importance of religion in the life of human beings. And inshallah we'll carry on from now on until the end of our program inshallah and until we meet again, hopefully sometime in the future. We've been saying that religion in general and from an Islamic perspective in particular is not something that comes to hinder or restrict or makes the life of a human being difficult. Rather, it comes to facilitate the human being and it comes to serve the human being. And we said from the outset that let us all agree on one thing, and that is that religion is here to serve man and not for man to serve religion. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created man in such a way that He wanted him to lead this life. So in order to facilitate his life, God has given him this religion to make his life a better life, not to make his life a hindrance for him or those that he associates with. We know for certain, therefore, that one of the most significant differences between man and other living being is the moral and the socio-moral aspect of man's existence. Man is not merely a physical being. On the contrary, man has a strong moral and spiritual aspect to his existence. What differentiates you from other creatures and from other lives on this earth is the fact that you have the moral aspect to your life which is sustained and backed by your spirituality. Because on the basis of your physical existence, without resort back to your spiritual dimension, there is no question of morality then. There is no question of existence, in fact, if there is no spiritual existence to your dimension and to your facets. And that's why we say the spirit is of paramount importance in understanding man's existence on this earth. Without that spirit which nurtures the spiritual existence of a man, man is worthless. You don't worth in the standard of a human life. A man without a spirit or a soul is absolutely worthless. You don't value in the market of humans, if I can use this terminology, anything of worth without your spirit. Therefore, we say that this moral and socio-moral aspect of man's existence is the very foundation on which societies have evolved over time. Without this socio-moral aspects of man's existence, we don't have laws in the world. Laws could not have existed nor developed in the world that we live in today. Be it in the legal aspect of his existence and his coming into this world, or be it in the social structure of his interaction with others in the world that we see at hand today. All the laws that you see developing in the world today are as a result of this socio-moral aspect of man's existence. It is in fact that the acceptance and appreciation and realization of mutual rights and responsibilities which has resulted in the strong bonds of families, friendship, tribes and society, what gave rise to that socio-moral acceptance of man's existence. Otherwise, if if there were no corresponding and reciprocal right and obligation among the humans themselves towards one another, this world will be in anarchy. And we see that with the absence of the social moral existence of such laws, we go into anarchy. And you can look around you, I don't have to quote examples of certain countries and certain cities where this anarchy actually exists, in order to understand and appreciate this very fact that I am referring to. And even at times, not only that the absence of the socio-moral standards among human that gives rise to anarchy, no, the misunderstanding of the application of religious laws that are based on the socio-moral aspect of human existence also gives rise not only to anarchy but to killing and murder as well. When I justify in the name of religion that you are no longer part and parcel of the faith that you and I belong to, and then, you know, the law of what we call the law in inverted commas, and I invite our Muslim scholars at large from both school of thought to reconsider their opinion of the law of apostasy in Islam and what they conceive the law of apostasy to be in the modern world that we are living in. Not because we want to override the law of apostasy, no, but because we want to understand the law of apostasy from directly the Quran itself, and not from our own desires and implication of what constitute an apostate and what does not constitute an apostate. Why I say that? Because the Quran is clear on that matter when it says, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We shall not cause any community or society to torment unless we send unto them a messenger. And the messenger in that regard is not necessarily the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because over the course of time and over the fabrication in the original message, due to the course of time and the misrepresentation of certain aspects of our societies, the beautiful religion of Allah that He had intended to mankind has been misrepresented and misconstrued. Therefore, when someone becomes disenchanted with Islam on the basis of what the media portrays today, and he pulls out from the faith, we cannot then ascribe the law of apostasy to him. Why? Because the religion itself has been misrepresented to him. Even at times, if he lived in a Muslim country. Why? Because he does not even know what is right and what is wrong anymore. He doesn't even know whether this religion that is being practiced is actually the pure version of the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as advocated and practiced by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and his household and the rightful companions, or is it the figment of imagination of people's own interpretation of what constitutes religion in today's world? And that's what creates a havoc and a major disaster, is that when I want to get rid of someone that I don't like, I can actually fire him with the accusation of being an apostate, and that's the end of a human life in our societies that we live in. And that is completely contrary to the nature and the spirit of Islamic law. When we talk about the law of apostate, although I'll take a bit of your time in that regard, we find that the ayah that speaks about this, and when I speak about the Quran, I speak the Quran from the perspective that the Quran should be the mirror image of the prophetic tradition, and not the prophetic tradition the mirror image of the Quran, in the sense that the prophetic tradition overrules the ayat of the Quran. This is absolutely unacceptable and rejected. When we have traditions of the Prophet overruling or overriding the ayat of the Quran. For example, re-examination of our jurisprudential edicts at times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وعاش, you know what? I don't dare speak about women issues anymore when I look at the audience.
Excuse me.
Yes. Bismillah.
There is a white Corolla driven by a lady. The number plate is AGL789. It's parked in the wrong place. If you could please go ahead. White Corolla, AGL789. Thank you.
Okay. Corolla or Honda?
9 is the number plate. Number is more important.
Give the key to someone,
give
sister.
Give us the
key. So sorry.
No problem. I'll send you the bell later, inshallah, for the interruption. So, on the I say I don't dare speak about women issue because I'm looking at the audience. Yani, I don't know. I've been told I am the women's sheikh these days. And people are complaining I'm giving too much right to the women. These are not something that I am yani giving as eid treats. This is what Allah wants and what the Quran wants. And I think if we look at what the Quran and what the traditions of the Prophet wants, I think our life would be much, much better than what it is now. Having said that, going back to this very issue, is that the Quran says when it speaks about relationship between husband and wife, it says وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and live with your wives amicably. This is the ayah of the Quran. Now what does jurisprudence tell us? Jurisprudence comes to tell us that if a husband, and I'm quoting what our jurisprudence books tells us, that if a husband marries a wife and tells her from day one, don't leave the house, she has to obey, right? And he keeps her until she dies, he has not done something against the spirit of jurisprudence. Okay? Why? Because they quote the Prophet to have said that a woman should not leave the house without the permission of the husband. Now I want to ask this. Will the Prophet say something contrary to the Quran? When the Quran says live with them amicably, is living with our wives amicably entails to keep them at home without leaving? That's not amicable. That is torture. That is torture. Then what is the Prophet talking about when he speaks about permission or seeking permission to leave the house? He's surely talking about the organizational of family rather than the restriction of movement of members of the same family. And that's what we need to understand when we talk of how we can harmonize what the Prophet says with the essence of the Quran and the spirit of the Quran. But it is unfortunate that the Quran has always been interpreted from a male perspective, not a female perspective. The female perspective has never been taken into perspective when it comes to the interpretation of the law of the Quran. Another verse, for example, which is very famous to all of us and very dear to our hearts, which is the ayah of Mubahala, right? Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was visited by the Christians of Najran in order to debate with him on the nature and the divinity or non-divinity of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. So, we are told proudly that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to accommodate the monks of Najran in the mosque, right? Which is the essence and the spirit of the Quran. Because the Quran says in Surah Al-Hujurat, what? وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. We surely have made you into nations and tribes that you may come to know one another. The most right, the most favorable among you in the eyes of Allah is the most righteous, right? So if the Prophet accommodates the Christians of Najran in the mosque, and then jurisprudence comes and tells me that I cannot invite Christians and Jews into the mosque, then there is a problem. Right? There is a problem in our understanding of the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what jurisprudence tells us sometimes. So we need to reconcile and re-examine some of our jurisprudential aspects of what constitute religion and what constitute proper understanding of the spirit and the essence of the Quran itself. Because the Quran is an invitation to mankind. Right? For example, another story. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, call to the way of your God and let people read the Quran. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. We have made Quran easy for people to read it, to examine it, to explore it, to identify themselves with it. Is there anyone who is able to contemplate it? And then when a Christian comes and says, I want a copy of Quran, you are najis. Right? So we have a problem. We have a problem with the essence of the Quran and what the Quran tells us and what we practice from a jurisprudential point of view. What I'm trying to say is that when we look at religion, religion must be looked at it from the perspective of Allah, not my perspective. From the perspective of the Quran, not from my own individual inclination towards what may constitute a particular item of faith or otherwise, right? Because by nature a human being is biased, right? He's biased. And we often use religion, as I said 2 days ago or yesterday, or 2 days ago in my statement, in explaining the hadith of Imam Hussein salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, in regard to those who remain faithful to their faith when they are being tested and tried. I said that sometimes we use Quran only, or Islam, when it suits us. But when it doesn't suit us, we don't want to know it. We don't want to use it and make it part and parcel in our lifestyle. So much so that Islamic law nowadays is restricted to what? To two things. Three things. Laws of inheritance, laws of marriage, laws of death. Other than that, you don't find Islam in any way of our life. Right? So much so that the Quran, when it speaks, in Surah Yasin. Is Surah Yasin good to read for our dead ones or not? Yeah, اقرأوا ياسين على موتاكم. Read Yasin for your dead ones. But you know, it's amazing when you read Surah Yasin, it doesn't talk about the dead, it talks about the living. It says, لِيُنذِرَ مَنْ كَانَ حَيًّا وَيَحِقَّ الْقَوْلُ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. So that you can give warnings to the living, not to the dead. Subhanallah. وَإِحْنَا يَاسِينَ وَالْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ. Yasin وَالْقُرْآنِ for who? For this guy who's going underground, 6 foot under. Oh, Yasin is for me, so I can learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling me. So the Quran is only good when so much so that when we walk the streets of our Muslim countries now and we hear the Quran being recited, the first question that comes to mind, who passed away? Ajeeb. Is the Quran for passing away only? Huh? Someone died today? No, it's not about that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, read the Quran, for Allah will reward you for it. For each letter you read, 10 hasanat, 10 blessings, 10 deeds. Surely, the Prophet is saying this hadith, surely I don't say alif lam meem, one letter, but alif is a letter, lam is a letter, meem is a letter. Subhanallah, which is the beginning of Ayat al-Baqarah, Surah al-Baqarah. So he said, read it, but don't read it with absent-mindedness. Ya ayyuhal ladina, la taqrabu salata wa antum sukara. Do not approach salah while you are in a state of intoxication. This state of intoxication is not talking about the Johnny Walkers and the Bombay Blue. Not only that state, no, the form or the dimension of intoxication that Allah speaks about is any form of intoxication. Yani when you come to approach Allah, forget the Nasdaq, forget the Nikkei, forget the FTSE, just for 5 minutes of your time. Don't be intoxicated by your work, don't be intoxicated by your Layla. Huh? Leave Layla for a minute, for God's sake. Huh? And be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that moment in your life, so you can experience and enrich your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the proportioner and the creator and the giver of every good and love in this world. So the whole corpus, therefore, of religion, brothers and sisters, is in fact based upon the realization, recognition, and acceptance on our part of the relationship between ourselves and the creator and the provider of this universe, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is something that we need to exercise, and that is something we need to accept and develop across the days and the years and whatever time we have in this world, in as far as our existence is concerned, and in as far as our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to understand what religion and spirituality is, and what is their role in the life of people, we should first and foremost all know the definition of what religion is. And if someone, you come and say, define religion to me, what do you say? You say, to say, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna muhammadan. No, this is not religion. This is faith. Okay? Religion is something else. So, what is the definition of religion? It says, religion is an all-round movement in the light of faith in a supreme, sovereign creator, and a sense of responsibility for the formation of thought and belief, where this belief leads to the promotion of high principles of human morality for the very purpose of the establishment of good relations among members of the society and the elimination of every sort of undue discrimination. This is the overall definition of what religion is all about. Now tell me something. If you tell any Tom, Dick and Harry in the world, this is the definition of religion, who would reject such a definition? But when we define religion, well, the first thing that comes into our definition of religion is, I am thou holier than you. No, I am more closer to Allah than you. I have the keys to Jannah, and you don't even gonna come near it, mate. Huh? And you're not gonna even taste it or even smell the essence of religion. Why? Because I've already made myself the guardian and the protector of the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much so that one day a mu'min in the times of one of the previous prophet was walking alongside one of his friends, and he said what? He said, by Allah, tallah innaka inna Allah la yaghfir lak, by God, Allah shall not forgive your sins. Immediately a state of emergency was declared in heaven. Jibreel was summoned to go down to the prophet and said to the prophet of the time, tell that person who claims to be a mu'min that I have already forgiven his friend and I have wasted his actions. Why? Because you have no right to assume Allah's positions on earth. Who are you to say you are forgiven? I am holier than you and you are less holier than me. I am at a prominent space higher than you. Then how do you know that? How do you know that? You don't know. You don't know. And on the basis of the story of what I told you about Musa, when Allah asked him to bring someone less of value than him, you can see that there is no way in the wildest of your imagination you can claim to be better than someone. No one can claim to be better than anyone in this life, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? He says, inna kulla shay'in khalaqnahu biqadar. Everything we have created in this world, we have created with proportion. Meaning what? Everything has its own due role in this world that it exists in. And that role, in that dimension and in that perspective, could be better than your role, because you will not fit to play that role. But only that individual or that thing or that creature is the one that is endowed with that particular role that Allah has proportioned for it to do and perform in this life. So you cannot claim superiority over anyone else. And that's why the concept of humbleness in Islam is so highly recommended with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the concept of pride, false pride, yani vanity. Huh? Someone who prides himself over others on the basis of something that does not deserve praise. Yani for example, a rich person who feels himself is better than a poor person. Firstly, your richness is not from you. Huh? That richness is granted from Allah to you as a mean of trial in this world. So that does not make you at a pedestal higher. And that reminds me of the story of a man who was rich, who came into the Prophet's session once, and the Prophet was giving a speech, and he sat in front of the Prophet, and he was wearing very nice, you know, clothes and what have you, very fancy colors and bling, God knows what, you know, Meccan bling style. So he came, or Medinian bling style, and he sat in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was very, very posh. And then a poor person came and sat next to him. So what did he do? He collected his abba and closer to him, so that that person does not touch him. So when the Prophet finished his discourse and his address to the people at the time, he directed his speech to that person. He said, what made you collect your clothes away from that person? Is it the fact that you were afraid some of your richness will transfer to him? Subhanallah. The man said, no, oh, were you afraid that some of your richness and wealth would transfer to him, or some of his poverty will transfer to you? The man said, neither of them, ya Rasulullah, was anticipated. The Prophet said, no, some of it was anticipated. Don't tell me I know what is inside your heart. He said, ya Rasulullah, how can I compensate for my bad pride? Because yes, I thought, you know, who is he, right? Who's this guy to come and sit next to His Highness? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's up to you and to your generosity to compensate for what you did. The man immediately turned to his brother, the less fortunate one. He said, I want to share half of my wealth with you to compensate for my arrogance. The man said, thank you so much, brother. May Allah bless you and bless your wealth. I don't need it. He insisted. The man refused. Then he said, why don't you want my wealth? He said, so I will not think the way you thought when I sat in the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't want to get that arrogance. Let me be a humble servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take your wealth. The real wealth is the wealth of contentment. That's the real wealth. When, you know, a person was at the time of Jesus salamullah alayh, and there is another story where a man went to the mosque once during Eid time. And please take plastic bags with you when you go to the mosque. So if you are wearing a Versace or a Christian Dior shoes, or God help you, that you don't lose the $400 on the spot. I bleed with blood, not tears, having to say that these are facts in our Muslim countries, that you can't even ensure that your shoes is safe in our Muslim countries. And I'm sorry to say or take the word shoes from the mimbar. So this man goes to the mosque, and this is a true story. As he exits, he's already bought the Christian Dior, the Muslim Dior, I don't know what Dior. Comes out, he doesn't find the shoes. Ya Allah, I come to pray. You tell us, come to your mosque. You look after us. He goes, the shoes. Right? Yeah, and do you want us to come or you don't want us to come? I don't know. Tell us, man. What's the story? Do you want us to come or you don't want us to come? And while he is saying these things, he's walking and talking to himself. All of a sudden, he finds someone saying what? Praise be to Allah that freed me from the ailments and the sickness of others. The guy looks at him and he finds him without legs. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahilladhi aafani mimma btala bihi ghayri. Praise be to Allah who gave me contentment and not made me complain. The man went to him. He said, from what did he cure you? From what? When you don't have legs, I'm complaining over a pair of shoes. And you don't have legs and you're saying, praise be to Allah. He said, yes, praise be to Allah that He gave me a heart that is content, not like yours. That you cry over a pair of shoes. He said, wallah, you have a point. Unbelievable. I'm complaining about a pair of shoes and you don't have legs. And look at us, ahna, when iftar comes time, God help the wife if she doesn't have 17 items of food on the table. Huh? Oh, God help the wife if the soup or the chandu, what is it? This? Walla the bokoras, walla I don't know what, does not have the appropriate, have the masala and salt. If you have a husband with a bad temper, Allahu Akbar, so that you don't have World War through breaking at the dinner table. Is it tasted but spit the food after, so that you can get the right, mashallah, salt. So His Highness comes and Allahu Akbar. The salt is good, the masala is good, everything is good, you know. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam comes to his house one day and he's married to 9 wives. He goes to the door of Hafsa. Do you have food, O Hafsa? No. Aisha? No. Habiba? No. Zainab? No. Salama? No. None of the wives have cooked that day to the Prophet. What did the Prophet say? Where were you? In Tariq Road? There is no Tariq Road in Medina. Huh? Where were you? Zainab Market? There's no Zainab Market in Medina, right? What were you doing, woman? You know what he said, Rasulullah? He said, oh Allah, bear witness that I'll continue my day in fasting. End of the problem. He diffused the whole situation. Why? Because when you do voluntary fast, you don't need niyyah from the day before, right? As long as you haven't eaten during the day, you can keep fast until the rest of the day. He said, ya Allah, you have until iftar time to sort yourselves out. Or if you don't sort yourselves out, doesn't matter, I'll break my fast on water or date. One of the wives of the Prophet, Aisha, namely herself, she says what? She says, most of the time the Prophet used to eat at home dates and milk. Most of his food, stable food for the Prophet, was date and milk. And sometimes, you know what he says? Look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, نعم الإدام الخل, the best gravy you can enjoy as a fantasy of food is what? Do you know what? Vinegar. بأبي أنت وأمي يا رسول الله. Vinegar to you was the best gravy that you soak your bread in and say that vinegar is one of the best gravy. Yani, you know what? That's a delicacy to the Prophet at that time. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah, you go to the West and you saw our children. KFC is not good enough. Macca's is not good enough. Not any. And God help the mother if she puts the same plate of food twice in a row. Huh? No, because there is no contentment. There is no contentment in our life. طيب. To continue the question on religion and to understand it from a better perspective, for a better understanding, we may roughly compare religion to a workplace. So what's the analogy between the two? What's the analogy between a workplace and religion? In a workplace, and you all agree with me in that regard, an employer promises to provide an employee with certain benefits and privileges in return for the employee's service. This is without any dispute in the matter. You provide a particular service to me as the employer, I recognize that service by a certain payment. In the course of this, you know, exchange of contracts between the employer and the employee, Islam intervenes, jumps in. I haven't finished my analogy between what the religion and the workplace, but I want to shed some light on the question of the rights of an employee. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says what? He says, "أعطِ الأجيرَ أجرَهُ قبل أن يجف عرقه." meaning what? Pay your employee in recognition of his service before his sweat dries up. Ihna, we sweat them, we whip them, we hit them, we abuse them, and we don't pay them. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Islam says no. When it comes to your worker, you must recognize his work before his sweat dries up. Because he's a human being like you. He has feelings. And by the way, if I tell you the rights of keeping someone at home to work from a pure Islamic perspective, no one will keep anyone at home. I gave this lecture once in Dubai. I've never been called back to the Jamaat. Because it's too much. You know, one of the rights of keeping a worker at home, according to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says what? He says, you must feed him from what you eat and dress him from what you dress. Yani, if I shop in Forum, he does not shop in Zainab Market. This is not a joke. I don't give him the leftovers. That's why the Prophet, when he came, he was not liked, by the way, brothers and sisters. You know why? Because he challenged the status quo. He challenged the status quo. Abu Jahl, when he was whipping Bilal, what was his argument in whipping Bilal? His argument was, Muhammad tells me that this slave and me are of equal value. No way. This slave I whip and I order and I own and I dismiss the way I want, while I am a master of Quraysh. The Prophet says, no, people are like the teeth of the comb. So they call the Prophet, you're a liar. You are challenging our status quo and safety zone. We will not accommodate you or accept you among us. We will expel you, because what you are telling us will create a revolution within our midst. And that's exactly what happened. That's how the Prophet changed the course of history. Salawatullahi salam. So much so that a person like Michael Hart, please go and Google Michael Hart. Who is Michael Hart? A fair dinkum, white, blonde, to the core of his bone, American-born writer. He writes a book and he calls the book The Greatest 100 Personalities in the World. After careful research of all the personalities in the world, he gives number one personality in the world to Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. You know where he puts Jesus? Number three. When he was asked how, on what basis, he says, because I have never seen a personality who was able to change the course of history and to challenge the very influencing factors of his environment and change it forever in less than 25 years of his existence. Then they said, you know what? What are you talking, man? These Arabs are going to get a big head. Review your book. Please do something. He says, all right. He says, I reviewed my book again and I went through the painstaking research of looking into the personalities of people of their time, and I found no other way but to declare in edition number two that Muhammad is the greatest personality of the world. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. You know why people now call the Prophet a fundamentalist? Because of this recognition. How are they going to change the people's mindset about the beautiful nature of the Prophet? That he's fanatic. And look what happens. We play in the hands of our what? Opponents. For example, they say the Prophet was a fanatic on the basis of what? On the basis of the way Muslims behave, right? So they come to challenge us intellectually. What do? They come up with a caricature against the Prophet, right? Where they put the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wearing a turban with a time bomb on it. And on that turban, it's written, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasul. You know the caricatures that came out of Denmark. Now the challenge comes to us as Muslims. How are we going to react to this intellectual challenge? I'll call it intellectual challenge. Although it is below people's feet, but I'm going to call it an intellectual challenge. How did we respond to that challenge? Exactly as they portrayed the Prophet in their sick mentality to be. We went down to the streets, we burned effigies, we attacked embassies, and we screamed and yelled and cursed our opponents. While the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he was placed in the same dimension, what would his reaction be? وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. When the ignorant one speak to them, they respond by saying peace, peace. Imagine if this Danish caricature or cartoonist, if I was a leader of a Muslim country, with all humbleness, you know what I would do? Wallah, I will send my own private jet to him, and I will invite him, and I'll put him in Burj Al Arab for 1 month. 1 month. Let's talk about the Prophet. Claim to be an intelligent human being. We are intelligent human. Let's talk. Let's dialogue. Let's debate. Let's explore. Let us not chuck rocks at one another. We are civil, modern human being. We don't need to go to that level of, you know, throwing axes. But instead, every time we are challenged intellectually, where do we go? To the streets. How do we behave? In the same way our opponents wants to prove a point against us, that we are barbaric, that we are fundamentalist, that we are fanatic, that we only understand the language of what? Of muscles. We don't understand the language of logic and intelligence. Subhanallah. And this is what we need to do. We need to change the dimension of thinking within our ranks. And that's why my heart goes out to the youth of our community, because they are the future. The youth of our community, brothers and sisters, and my appeal is to the parents. They represent half of our present and all of our future. And if we lose them, then we would have lost half of our present and all of our future. And that is something we can't afford to lose. To lose our youth means losing our identity and future, and it is happening fast. Faster than the Fast and the Furious. Right? Part 2 or 3, oh God knows what part is coming out. Maybe part 5 now. Eh? We have already exceeded part 10 in the way, at the rate we are losing our brothers and sisters in that regard. Obviously, brothers and sisters, and I will quote my last statement for the day, and so we can continue. An effective and a useful employee would only be the one who fully appreciates the purpose of his employment, the work that his employer expects of him, and then tries his best to fulfill the purpose of his job and the expectation of his employer, in order that due recognition is extended to that individual employee. We will continue tomorrow to see how does religion relate to that, in as far as our relationship with one another and in as far as our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know, the clock says 45 minutes, it feels like 25 minutes, but what can I do? With this I conclude. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala آله الطيبين الطاهرين.
Before we have our Q&A session, there's a couple of announcements for you. As explained, tomorrow's Amal will be extended, therefore the program will start earlier than normal. We shall have Hadith-e Qissa at 9:15 and Sheikh Jehad's lecture at 9:30. The second announcement is the ladies' sessions, which were announced to commence from tomorrow through Friday. They will be at the Al-Murtaza School, Al-Murtaza Recreational Center next to Mehfil Al-Murtaza, not at Sugra Bhai Auditorium, because that is what was subsequently announced. However, they will be now at the recreational center from Tuesday to Friday from 3:30 to 4:30 for ladies only. Now we'll proceed to the question answer session. There are two ways of asking questions. You can either write them down. We have volunteers on both sides with pieces of paper and writing instruments. Or you can request for the mic. The mic is also going to be available on both sides. Please keep your questions short and precise so that we have more time for more questions and more answers. Thank you.
Today? Really? MashaAllah.
Regarding your reaction of Muslims towards the damage consciousness, I don't think anyone of us living here to through the streets or participated in the violence. But the responsibility for the chaos still falls on us. What is it that we as the educated elite do in such a situation, and what is our responsibility regarding it?
I think education is the best means to tackle this problem. If none of us have taken to the street and there is a healthy phenomena and a healthy practice that we don't do these things, but that is not enough, because the majority, we are unfortunately sometimes the intellectual part of our community are always the silent majority. It is always the vocal minority that are taking to the street and misrepresenting the vocal the silent majority. And what we need to do is tip the scale where the silent majority must now take over from the vocal minority, because otherwise we will always be misrepresented in that regard. We must take the initiative of expressing our thoughts on the matter, and I think with the social networks that are available to us now in the world today, we can play a very constructive role and part in expressing and airing our views in that matter in a civil, educated, intelligent matter when it comes to question of, you know, such as the Danish cartoonists and so on and so forth, and not allow the scope or the ground for the minor or the vocal minority to take and hijack the intellectual religion of Islam in that regard. But are we doing that? Okay, we are educated, but within the midst of our ability to debate an issue and dialogue on an issue and discourse on an issue, did we, yes, you said very gracefully, we did not take to the street. Did we then take to the computers? Did we take to Facebook? Did we take to Twitter? Did we take to MS Messenger? Or were we busy chatting about, you know, a nice recipe for iftar or the latest fashion hairdo that comes from Cosmopolitan and News Weekly and goes God knows what? I mean, this is what we need to do as the a silent majority in changing and challenging what challenges that we are facing on a daily basis, in order to create a sense of change and a sense of paradigm change in how the West look upon us in the East or in the Muslim world in general in that regard. Yes.
A spoken question?
Yeah. I can hear you, brother, without coming.
My question is about use of Adhan.
Yes.
Or, challenges to religion. I've heard from certain schools of thought that it is haram to use Adhan.
Okay.
But somehow that doesn't make sense to me. So can you elaborate on how we are supposed to use intelligence in arriving in religion?
I think there is no doubt in anyone's sane mind that aql is the very essence and purpose of the creation of a human being, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created, please brother, you can when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the aql or the intelligent, it was one of his first creation. In fact, the hadith tells us that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the aql as his first creation, what did he say? Allah acknowledged, by my majesty and sovereignty, I have not created anything that is more beloved to me than you. So that intelligence of the human being, or the mind of a human being, is the most precious and most beloved creation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the riwayah or the hadith tells us how Allah spoke to the aql by asking it to move forward and then to move backward, and then Allah spoke to it and said, by majesty and my sovereignty, it is on your basis that I either reward or I reprimand, right? So from that perspective, who can then say or claim that there is no scope for the aql in our religion? In fact, we said, I don't know if you were with us a few days ago, brother, I said, is believing in God a matter of pure faith, or is it based on aql and intelligence? And we find that the Quran is the one that responds to such a question when it is being posed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah says to the Prophet, O Muhammad, you must learn that there is no God but Allah. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He did not say فَآمِنْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, right? So the question of dismissing intelligence from our setup of Islam is something that goes against the very core and essence of the Quran itself. Because if you look at the Quran, you will find that in every statement or second statement or third statement in the Quran, it is only aql and intelligence that is emphasized. أَفَلَا يَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ أَفَلَا يَفْقَهُونَ. You know, should they not contemplate? Should they not ponder? Should they not think? Should not reflect? So to whom is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking when he says, should they not reflect? To the malaika? He's talking to the human beings, to the human race. Let them use their intelligence, and let them not allow others to think for them, but let them think with them and not think for them. Our problem, brothers and sisters, in our Islamic setup is, for so long we made others think for us, when we are as capable as these people, that we should think with them and not allow them to think for us all the way through. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and mind you, Islam is the only religion that says you can ask anything you want. Any other religion says you can't. It's a matter of faith. It's a matter of faith. And you can go and ask many of these brothers and sisters who have reverted to Islam, what was the key purpose or the triggering point in them reverting from their own set of laws or faith to Islam? They will say the fact that Islam allows us to ask a question and allows us to get answers, because the Islam encourages. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he revealed the Quran to the Prophet, what did he say to him? Pray. He said to him, believe. He said to him, read. And we are a nation that doesn't read, unfortunately. You know, how many universities do we have in the Muslim world compared to how many universities we have in the West? How many books we produce a month or a year in reference to what is being produced elsewhere? And we are the ummah of what? Of read, not the ummah of sleep. Huh? We are the ummah of read in that regard. And when someone poses the question that we cannot ask question, then simply respond to him by saying, حدث العاقل بما لا يليق له فإن لاق له فلا عقل له. Speak to someone who supposedly sane about a proposal which is insane. If that sane person believes what you are telling him is sane, then surely he is insane. Do you get it? Yes. Sorry, these ones? Okay.
We will now go with the written.
Okay.
We will now... You can just say it, right?
I understand that homosexuality is haram. How do I convince someone who says they are born this way and to...
To convince them otherwise.
Is it?
To condemn people
to hell is unjust in the religion of Islam. Yes, I think the question of homosexuality should be looked upon as any way we look in Islam about sin. Because these people are sinners or not? They're sinners. Yani, is homosexuality is any less of a crime than alcohol, for example? But we have never seen someone saying, you know, someone who's drink alcohol, for example, is kill him or maybe some people do. But I'm saying it's a sin, and we should look at it as a sin. In saying so, that when I look at something as a sin, I should also not deprive a sinner from my guidance and my ability to convince them and reach out to them to bring them back to the right path. Even if they are exercising such a horrible sin or horrible, and the question of I am born like that is senile. It's absolute insanity, because it has not yet proven, even from medical perspective, that someone could carry a gene called homosexual gene. There's no such thing as, and I can prove it even scientifically, that there is no such existence of such a gene within our midst or within our creation. And then to carry the argument further, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he creates on the basis of justice. He cannot create someone and implicate him with a gene called homosexuality and then burns him to death. It does not make sense in the scope of Allah or the plan of Allah or the scheme of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Condemning to hellfire is the agency of Allah, not my agency. It's not my shop, it's not my window front to have keys for people to go to hellfire. And if you need any further notes on the subject to prove that homosexuality is not something that someone is born with, I have a lot of material to disprove that homosexuality is a natural thing that someone is born with. But the reason why they say so is that because this group of people have an agenda to pursue so that they will be accepted as part and parcel of the world we are living in, as something very normal and very natural. Please shed some light on the differences between zakat and khums. Let there be no mistake or no misunderstanding whatsoever that the Shia school of thought does not say that zakat is compulsory. Zakat is as compulsory as khums. But when does zakat become payable? That is the difference of opinion between the school of thought. In fact, according to the Sunni brothers in the Sunni school of thought, they are of their belief that khums also exist. And not only khums exist on the spoils of war. No, according to Abu Hanifa, Malik, Ahmad and Shafi'i, khums becomes payable on the resources that are dug from underground. Yani, there is khums on petrol, oil, khums on gold, or zakat on gold, khums on uranium, khums on anything that is that comes out of the ground as a treasure that is underground, you must pay khums on it. Right? So if you look at the concept of khums and zakat in Islam, in comparative school of thoughts, you will find that there's a lot of similarities between the two. But we say that khums is specific, sorry, zakat is specific to gold, silver, plantation and cattle. Yani sheep or camels or anything in that department. If you are a farmer that cultivates crops or cultivates cattle, if you are a merchant of gold or silver, then you have to pay zakat on these items. And if you accrue other income from any other place, then you pay khums on that. Right? So let there be no mistake that zakat is exclusively for the Sunni brothers and khums is exclusively for the Shias, or that zakat does not exist in the Shia school of thought and only exists in the, or that our Sunni brothers do not actually pay khums. No, this is heresy. They do pay khums when the khums is actually due in certain perspective. Dear Sheikh, is music allowed in Islam? According to your marja of taqleed, some of them allow it. Some of them say categorically music is not allowed. And some of them they say no, not all music is haram. Some music is halal, depending on the way and the reason and the lyrics and the motion, the motive behind the use of music. So if you happen to be a muqallid of a certain marja and he says that you can listen to music, I humbly say to my brothers and sisters, do not go on the attack if you happen to be a muqallid of another marja that says music is haram, and condemn the muqallideen of this marja that says music is halal because your marja says it's haram. There should be some sort of appreciation and acceptance and respect in matters of differences between muqallideen of different maraja of taqleed. And if you are of the opinion, according to your own marja of taqleed, that your marja of taqleed is at the same level of knowledge as another marja of taqleed, then you can do rujoo' to him in any matter of law that you see fit in that within these parameters. We had a certain sum of money saved up. We decided to put it in the bank. Our father suggested us to put it in saving account. Upon doing so, we were told that we are entitled to receive 8.5% per annum as interest. Are we allowed to use this money? If not, then what do we do? No, you can use it according to all maraja of taqleed on the basis that you are actually saving this money from going into the hands of the unknown or not knowing what is going to happen to this money. So on the basis of istinqadul mal, as they say it, or saving this money from going into means that are not known or to individuals that have no real ownership over this money, it is better that you take it. You can either use it or donate it in that regard, and there is no hurma or haram in that regard. Can you please emphasize on the importance of taqleed, as so many young and old are not following a marja? I said in more than one discourse of my lectures that taqleed is something that is important, because in Islam you can be either of three scenarios. You can either be a muqallid, a follower, or you are a mushtahid in your own right, where you don't have to do taqleed to anyone, you do taqleed of yourself due to certain advancement of studies that you pursue within the faculty of jurisprudence, or you become a marja and people follow you. So the choice is yours. You don't want to become a muqallid, become a mushtahid, you know, and don't follow anyone, right? Be your own mushtahid in that regard. Why do we say taqleed is of importance? It's simple, because not every one of us is an expert in the four principles of extrapolating laws of Islam. Yani, I'm not fully versed and an expert on the laws of Quran or the Quran, the sciences of the Sunnah of the Prophet, the sciences of consensus and the sciences of Aql. If I don't have enough knowledge to sustain me in order to understand these four principles, so that based on these four principles I am able to extrapolate laws when I confront them, then I have to be a follower. Simple as that. And if I'm not a doctor, I can't self-proclaim myself to be a surgeon, because if I start performing surgeries on people, I am doomed, and the one under my hand are dead already, right? So that is why Islam says that when you surrender your life into the hand of an expert without having to block your intelligence, right? Yani, for example, tell me something. If you go to a specialist and the specialist says smoking is not good for you, right? Do you trust his judgment, or do you go to a butcher to take a second opinion? I'm being very open and very frank. Do you go to forget smoking? Maybe sometimes smoking is too much close to our hearts. Even if the father of experts told us that smoking is bad, we'll still smoke, right? But let's say someone tells you that you have diabetes, well, sugar is bad for you, right? Would you still take sugar? Would you still take something that will raise your sugar level? And he's an expert or a marja' or a point of reference in his field of expertise or not? Surely you surrender your physical dimension into the hands of that particular specialist without having to put a stop to your intelligence, right? Because he's an expert in the field. Similarly is the case when it comes to the question of a marja. However, my opinion, personal opinion, and I'm not imposing my personal opinion, and I share my personal opinion with many mujtahids and maraja of taqleed in that regard, and not one of them, but more than one of them, is that we are in an age and era where maraja of taqleed are now at the same level of knowledge, a'lamiyya. There is hardly you can say that there is a marja who is higher in knowledge in all the faculties of what constitute a marja than another person when it comes to comparing maraja of taqlid in today's world. If you think that your marja is a'lam, that's a different story, and I cannot dismiss that belief if you have that belief. I'm not saying that at all, but I'm saying in the general standard of how mujtahids view maraja of taqlid in today's world, they see that they are at the same level of a'lami. Based on that, can we then do rujoo' from one to another under the perspective and the dimension and the belief of what we call the collective marja'iyya system than the individual marja'iyya system as it has been for so long going in the world of Muslims in our existence from the time of Al-Imam Al-Hujjah Ajallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif until the current prevailing time that we are in. As a safe, to safeguard your religion, it is very logical to follow a marja in that regard in order to know that what you are doing at least falls within the parameters of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from you. This is all the questions.
Follow-up question from
Yes. I have more questions. Yes.
You just mentioned about zakat and book. I mean, it always comes to my mind that we as Shias hardly pay zakat. I mean, it's not applicable. The truth is, it's applicable only to a restricted field.
Yes.
Whereas our books is applicable on our net income.
Yes.
Now, books is distributable to Sadat and Sam Imam.
Yes.
What happens to the non-Sadat? I mean, how do they get help compulsorily? I mean, people say that, okay, you give charity, but it is not compulsory. So the non-Sadat are deprived of this benefit.
Why is that so? But they can get from Sahmi Imam.
No, from Sahmi Imam only the Sadat can get it.
From Sami Sadat they can get it.
Actually, Sami.
Yeah, so if they're getting it from Sami Sadat, they're not getting it from Sahmi Imam, right? So we cannot pay to the poor from the Sahmi Imam?
Well, it depends. You see, the problem is, practical problem is, for Sami Imam, it goes to the Marja.
Okay. I will advise you to do this. I'll advise you to this. Write to your Marja of Taqlid and tell him, on what basis is khums paid to a marja? Alright? And find out what the answer will be. And then I will debate the issue with you further. Okay? On what basis is khums paid to a marja in the first place? And why is it paid to a marja in the first place? Alright? And inshallah next year I'll be here and we'll continue the debate on this issue. I'm not trying to escape the question. I'm trying to create a venue for food for thought. Food for thought. Yes. One more question. Yes. It is on. Okay.
तो वैसे ये गुजराती में बोलो और बट मैं तुम नहीं समझूंगा सवाल ये है कि सरकार के बारे में बात हो रही है तो इस सिलसिले में डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन के बारे में मैंने एक आलेख रिव्यू किया और मैंने उनको कहा कि भाई अगर सैन्य साझा से कुछ आता है जरूरतमंद आता है तो हमें अंदेशा है कि इसमें से 10 में से 3 कारीगर भी हो सकते हैं. तो उस सूरत में अगर हम सैन्य साझा के लिए साझा लोगों के लिए तो प्रोजेक्ट बनाए वो पैसा जो है सैन्य साझा का तो वहाँ पर खर्च करें. तो एक आदमी ने मुझे कहा कि कतई नहीं, इसलिए कि ये साझा का हक है, आपको उसको हैंड ओवर करना है, उसका कब्जा उसको चाहिए. आने से मैंने पूछा, वो भी काबिल इज्जत थे और ललित आदि थे, उन्होंने कहा नहीं कभी कोई बात नहीं है, आप व्यापारी हैं, बिजनेसमैन हैं, आप वो पैसा ज़्यादा प्रूडेंटली इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, इन्वेस्टमेंट कर सकते हैं. तो बेहतर ये है कि आप खुद के लिए कोई हाउसिंग स्कीम बनाएं, कोई मेडिकल स्कीम बनाएं, कोई बनाए आप खर्च करें वो ज़्यादा बेहतर है, इसलिए कि आपकी जिनको ज़्यादा मिलेगी. तो मैं कंफ्यूज हूँ, तो मैं आपसे पूछना चाहता हूँ कि इसमें से कौन सा रास्ता अख्तियार किया जाए, क्योंकि दोनों अली माशाल्लाह काबिल इज्जत हैं और वाकई में अली में जीत है. तो मुझे प्लीज क्लियर करें कि आपने हम करें क्या.
Question pertains to the distribution of Sena Sadat.
Yes.
The gentleman asked an alimatin as to whether he can use the money of Sena Sadat to establish a project for the benefit of Sadat.
Mm-hmm.
One alim told him that no, you cannot. This money belongs to the Sadat. You have to give it to them and they may do as they please with the money. Another alim said to him, no, you are a prudent businessman, you know better how to invest, you can set up a project, either medical or housing or whatever you please.
Does he know this? Does he know this alim?
He knows both the alim.
No, the other one that told him, you can do, you're a prudent. Yes. Is he within our community? Can I meet him to kiss his hand? Huh?
He's in our community, yes.
I tell him, Sheikh Jehad would like to kiss your hand.
From Najaf.
I think you got my answer, Haj.
From Najaf.
Well, I'm telling you from the mimbar.
Of course, with his permission, I will give you the name.
Yeah, and with your permission, pass on the message to him that Sheikh would like to kiss your hand for that answer.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, I'll come in.
I was just yesterday and you discussed something along the lines of
Hello.
Yeah. Okay. You mentioned an event of our Imam where he invited the daughters of Marwan to his home, to live in his home. And that showed a sign of forgiveness.
Yes.
Right? And now my question is that if we pray usually in our big nights, we usually pray and we do ziyarats and everything, then most of us ziyarats use the lana. Now we give lana to the people who killed Amir al-Mu'mineen, for example, and people who killed Imam Hussein. Why do we practice that if we are taught by our imams to be forgiven?
I will answer this in one way. I don't want to dismiss it, I don't want to endorse it, I don't want to go into the debate of this particular question at hand, and I'm not trying to escape the question in any way, shape or form. What I think is right within the parameters of Sharia, I will practice it, and that is my derogative and my belief system. If I don't practice La'an, am I less of a Shia than anyone else? Just a question. Is that your answer?
You can proceed a couple of...
I can? Okay. You talked about divorce. Now what if the woman asks for divorce and the man does not pay the haq mahar? What will happen then to that man? Would he be freed from any question in the hereafter? I don't understand the question correctly. But if what the person asking the question is hinting at is that the man will use every maneuver in his available to him to escape paying the haq, and then let me tell you from a jurisprudential and an Islamic point of view, the haq of a mahr of a woman in the eyes of Sharia, in the eyes of Allah, if not equal, if not higher, it's equal in severity to usurping the money of an orphan. Yani, imagine taking the money of an orphan away from him, taking the money and the haq of the wife from her without her consent or her waiver over the money, amounts to usurping and taking away the money of an orphan. Yani, it's not gonna, yani means that is, okay, in Arabic, that is, if you come on the day of judgment thinking that you were such a clever entrepreneur for getting yourself out from taking or getting yourself out from paying the haq, you're not gonna escape Allah on the day of judgment. And this is haq of ibad among themselves, yani the haq of people among themselves, which something that Allah says, I will not interfere on the day of judgment in settling the dispute among you. So much so that we have riwayat, and tomorrow is Laylatul Qadr, right? 23rd, tomorrow is Laylatul Qadr. I'm telling myself and appealing to all my brothers and sisters now, if you have usurped the haq of any human being, make sure you resolve it before tomorrow, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us through the Prophet and the Imams that your a'mal will not be raised to heaven if you don't pay people's the due right. It will be hung. It will not reach the heaven. It will not even go beyond your head. So wallah, if you pray 100 rak'at or 1000 rak'at, or you praise the Muhammad wa al Muhammad, it will not go above our heads if we have usurped the right of people. I remember, my time is over? Okay. I get scared when someone stand next to me. Is it no, brother Muhammad?
Sorry.
Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I remember in 2004, 2005, I'm not sure, 2003, I was invited to speak in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. And I spoke in the last three nights of Ramadan, the holy month of Ramadan, about the rights of people over one another, hukuk of ibad. Subhanallah, on the eve of the third night, I received an anonymous letter. It got delivered to my home where I'm staying. And I read, and the letter says what? Sheikh, after listening to your lectures yesterday, there was a dispute between myself and my own brother, blood brother, after the demise and the death of my father. And this dispute has lasted so far for 10 years, where I have not spoken to my brother, our children don't know one another. Those children who were 10 now are 20 and they don't know one another. But yesterday, for the first time, we had iftar together. I said, Ya Allah, this is one of the excellent letters I've ever heard. And he continues and he said, the reason why is because after I heard your lecture, and listen, brothers and sisters, listen, the dispute is over what? $10? $20? 100,000 American. He said, I went to the bank, I transferred $100,000 into my brother's account so that I will not stand on the day of judgment in front of Allah. And Allah says to me, why did you take this $100,000 from your brother? Let me tell you also, Sheikh, it was the most rewarding moment of my time when I sat with my brother on the same table and the family members exchanged greetings for the first time after 10 years. This is hukuk al-ibad. Huh? The rights of people. Don't pay charity if you have usurped the right of someone. It will get you nowhere. Fix your problem with your brothers and sisters before you go and do other acts of charity. Because that is one of the ways that guarantees you, inshallah, a very safe passage to Jannah and the hereafter. One more question? One more question. This is a, yani, I think Zahra, 9 years old, is asking the question. If Zahra is here, Zahra, I take my hat off in respect to such a question to you. And if you want me to physically do it, I'll do it. But you come closer to me, so I'll do it for you. So no one can see my messy hair. Why did Allah create Shaitan when he knew that he will be bad? Very logical question. This is an intelligent question. This is not a funny question. This is in fact a very intelligent question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the course and the scheme of life, He said from the outset that when I will put you on this earth, I will challenge you. I will examine you. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Will people think that they will be placed on this earth without trial and for them to claim that they are believers? Yeah, everyone can claim I'm a believer. Everyone say I am, you know, the closest person that can be there to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the only way to verify such a statement is if you are put to a test, if you are put to a challenge, right? The only way, brothers and sisters, you can shape gold, and we all love gold, especially this section. Gold is it has an amazing glitter to it, right? And we love it. Tell me something, can you shape gold without challenging it to fire? You can't. You can't get gold and shape it the way you want, in the fashion you want, in the glitter you want, to give you the best end product, unless you put it to the fire, right? I'm not saying Allah wants to put us to the fire to glitter, but Allah puts us to a challenge to glitter. So was Satan part of the plan? Yes, he was part of the plan. It's not like Allah didn't know, he knew. But his plan was for us to prove to ourselves, with the potential that Allah has created within us, that we can overcome that challenge, because we are God vicegerent on earth. We are God representative, and God representative have the means to overcome it only if they are challenged. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the scheme of His infinite wisdom, in a nutshell, created the medium of Satan. Done? Certain match?
Not sure.
Not yet. Sure.